Good morning, everyone, and happy Mother's Day. I hope this is a wonderful day for all you moms and you grandmas out there that even though families may not necessarily be able to get together as a whole family, that still you can feel the love and know how important you are to your families, to this church, and to all of us. The Lord was incredibly gracious when he blessed us with mothers and a mother's love. Just one more thing before we begin, too, is I know how difficult this is. It's difficult to go into whatever week this is. I think week 9 or Sunday 9, where we haven't met. And I just want to say, keep going, be strong, it's hard. But the Lord is with us, he's with you. He's, again, gracious in that we can meet in this fashion. And one of the things it affords us is Sunday is now a very quiet day. It's a day where we don't get up and just get to work really quickly, get lunch on and get our clothes on and make sure we rush off to church. It's a day where everything's slow. And so it can be used as a day of rest. And so I encourage you, when this service ends, to not let the worship end, but to be in your home worshiping our God from morning to evening. With that, though, we come to an actual service where the Lord constitutes this and he calls us, and his call to worship is out of Psalm 147, verses 1 through 7. There he calls us and saying, "Praise the Lord, for it is good to sing praises to our God, for it is pleasant and a song of praise is fitting. The Lord builds up Jerusalem, he gathers the outcasts of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He determines the number of the stars. He gives to all of them their names. Great is our Lord and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure. The Lord lifts up the humble. He casts the wicked to the ground. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make melody to our God on the lyre." Let's respond to that call in prayer. Father, as we come now into your presence, we ask that you are with us, that we can know that you have brought this time on us, the separation on us, but that doesn't mean that we can't be with you, that you aren't gathering with us in our homes now. And so I ask that this is a time of true worship, a time truly where we encounter you, where the prayers offered, the words read and preached, and the songs sung can touch us in our hearts to let us know that we have one Lord, one intercessor, one faith, and one God who is sovereign above all. Be glorified in this time, Lord, and sweep us up into the highest heaven, that we may know and taste and see your beauty. For in Christ's name we come. Amen.
Come on to your voice, you sing to the voice.
This morning in our sermon, we'll be looking at Jesus as our great high priest, and we come back, as we did last week, to the Westminster Larger Catechism. And question and answer 44 asks and responds with what it means and how Jesus is a priest, and then we see what that means for us in Hebrews chapter 4. But again, in Westminster Larger Catechism 44, it is asked, how does Christ execute the office of a priest? And the answer is, Christ executes the office of a priest in his once offering himself a sacrifice without spot to God to be a reconciliation for the sins of his people and in making continual intercession for them. And then in Hebrews, the author there in Hebrews chapter 4, verses 14 through 16 tells us what that means for us. He says, since then we have a great high priest who passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in our time of need. Because it's Mother's Day, we have several different people who have recorded prayers or come in to record prayers, and so they will be leading us in the congregational prayer at that time, and then I'll close as well.
Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we come to you today to give thanks for our mothers, We thank you that in your wisdom you created mothers that would love and nurture us as children. Father, we know that you are compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in love toward your children. Thank you for mothers that demonstrate those attributes so that we can better see them in you, our God. I want to give you thanks for my mom, who lived out her life before me consistently and faithfully, following you. Never in my life did I ever doubt that my mom's faith was real. As my parents lived out their life, it was undeniable you were real and that they had a personal relationship with you. Lord, so many in our church have had that privilege of growing up in a Christian home. And as we get older, we understand more and more what a profound blessing it is to be born into that covenant family. This too is grace from you to us. May we be humbled by your love for us and always give you the praise for all you have done for our salvation, including giving us godly mothers. In Christ's name, amen.
Dear God, thank you for a mom who loves me, a Jima who lets me have sleepovers at her house, a grandma who makes us treats on our bike rides, and a nana who spoils me with chocolate. I love them all. Amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for our mom, and in Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Thank you for the talents you have given her to create beauty through growing flowers and designing flower arrangements. Lord, I ask that I can be a blessing to my mom.
Dear Father, we thank you for mothers. We thank you, Lord, for the nurturing they have, Lord. In your word, you teach us that we were knit together in our mother's womb. Thank you, Lord, that you designed it so that mothers are the place where we start our lives. Thank you, Lord, for the connection and the bond that is formed there and that lasts a lifetime. Lord, for Martha, I ask that you would bless her. Thank you for her talents, for her endurance. Ask you give her strength to continue on in motherhood. And for my own mom, Lord, I thank you for the things that she's taught me. Thank you, Lord, for her ability to create fellowship and unity through meals and hospitality. We ask that you would bless her as well. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Dear God, I just want to thank you for mothers and grandmothers and all the people that have supported me through our church. I just thank you for my mom. She's supported me. She's loved me. She's taken care of me. She's taught me about you. She's taught me about all the things that I need to know in life. I thank you for grandmothers. I just thank you that that they can support us, that they can love us, and they're just there to kind of show us the way of eternal life in you. I thank you for all the many ladies in our church who have supported me, who have taught me more about you through their actions, and who have had just such a great impact on my life and helping me to be able to know you better. Just thank you for all the blessings and the ways that they have shown me to you through all their caring and loving and just the way that they show me to you. In Jesus' name.
Our Father in heaven, we come to you in Jesus' name to thank you for your gift of our mothers and grandmothers. We thank you for the many ways they show your faithfulness, your gentleness, and your life-giving love. We ask your rich blessing on each one. Please give them your strength when they are weak, your joy when they are sorrowing, your wisdom and guidance when they are questioning, your peace and patience when they feel turmoil, your presence when they are alone, your abundance when they are in need, and your healing when they are hurting. Please give us hearts to honor and bless them in return. In all this, we want to show the greatness of your glory and goodness. Amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you, God, for blessing us with wonderful mothers thank you for all the things that they do for us. They show us love, patience, and faithfulness every day. Please bless the mothers at Mountain View with good health and watch over them. Please give them a good day of rest and let us honor them with kind words and actions. We love you, Jesus. Amen.
Father, we thank you for all these prayers, for the ability to see these faces again and to hear these voices. And we ache so much to be together as a family, and we ask that that comes soon. But in the meantime, we ask that you bless the families that were represented and the families that were not represented, especially the families that we wish could be. Father, of course, be with the mothers and the grandmothers, as has already been prayed, but be also with those who cannot have children, those who are aching to be mothers, those who are aching to be fathers, and for whom this day is especially difficult. We ask that you're near them, that you teach them the words of Scripture that say, "Rejoice, O barren woman." Lord, give them joy through all of this. Help them to feel no shame. Help them to feel no angst in it all, but that they can feel comfort in knowing that you are a sovereign God. But with that, of course, Lord, we ask that you bless them with children. Not only that they can rejoice, but that we can rejoice with them. And we thank you, Father, that each and every day and each and every week we can celebrate that you have made us your children. And so as we bless our mothers today, we ask that we bless you as well. In Christ's name, amen.
Victory win, there's wonderful power in the blood.
This morning, we're continuing our look at the three offices that Jesus fulfills, that, of course, of prophets, of priest, and of king. And last week, we saw that Jesus is God's greatest prophet, who speaks to us the final and full word of God's will for our salvation. As a prophet, we talked about how he came to deal with our spiritual ignorance. Next week, we'll look at him as a king, but here today, we look at him as a priest and how he deals with our sin. And so we'll be in Hebrews chapter 7, verses 26 through 28. But before, as always, we read, we need the Lord to be with us. And so I ask that you join me in prayer. Father, we come now to your word, and we thank you for the ability to open it and to discuss the depth of what it means that Christ is our priest. And we thank you that for some of us, this is a refresher, that we can just sit and take in the wonders of what it means. But Lord, for those of us who have not seriously considered this, we ask that it penetrates deep, that it hits deep into the heart and the soul, that it can change who we are. But that all of us together can walk away from your word today and going into the rest of our lives, reflecting and knowing that you have sent a representative to fight for us, to make us clean, and to one day present us as a pure, spotless bride. In Christ's name we come, because it is Christ who intercedes for us. Amen. Again, our passage this morning is Hebrews chapter 7, verses 26 through 28. It's very short, and it has a whole backbone to it that talks about Christ as our high priest, Christ as our priest. If you've been going through the Hebrews reading, you'll be familiar with this, but it picks up quite abruptly, but it's very difficult to find a place to pick it up. And so we just start in Hebrews chapter 7, verse 26, and this is God's word. For it was indeed fitting that we should have such a high priest, holy, innocent, unstained, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. He has no need, like those high priests, to offer sacrifices daily, first for his own sins and then for those of the people, since he did this once for all when he offered up himself. For the law appoints men in their weakness as high priests, but the word of the oath, which came later than the law, appoints a son who has been made perfect forever. This is God's holy, inerrant, and inspired word. Now, as we jump into it, we'll start by asking two questions, a little bit like we did last week. And the first is, what is a priest or a biblical priest? And then the second question is, why do we need them? And of course, we'll look at Christ as our high priest and then spend quite a bit of time trying to apply that to our daily lives. But to put it simply, what is a priest? A priest in the Old Testament was one who facilitated proper worship in Israel. Of course, that's an oversimplification, but one of their chief functions, and what we want to focus on today, is that they were to offer sacrifices on behalf of the people as a way to find forgiveness for their sin. In other words, as I've said, and as we talked about last week, a prophet represented God to the people, his word to the people. But a priest represents the people to God, because the priest would offer the way and facilitate the way for the people to be cleansed and forgiven. Now, in order to be a priest, you needed to be from the tribe of Abraham's great-grandson, Levi, whose later descendant, Aaron, who was the brother to Moses, was the first high priest. And so when we're looking at the Old Testament priesthood, or the priesthood of Judaism or Christianity, it is called the Levitical priesthood. Now, why do we need priests? Well, the answer always goes back to Genesis 3 and the fall, doesn't it? Because right there, what happened was Adam and Eve were banished from the Garden of Evil, and it meant no one again could have access to God. And this was carried on as a theme throughout Scripture, because it was even represented in the way that the tabernacle and the temple, the places where the priests ministered, the tabernacle being the non-permanent movable form, the temple being the permanent form that was set up in Jerusalem, that's how that was designed. So for example, at the dead center, there's a room called the Holy of Holies, or the Most Holy Place, and in it dwelt the Ark of the Covenant, where the presence of God was. And that was always closed off by a curtain so that none could pass through. The next room after that was called the Holy Place, where only the priests were allowed. It was followed by the inner courts, then the outer courts, and finally the court of the Gentiles. But once again, that was a visual, it was a reminder, it was a message that you couldn't have access to God, you couldn't draw near to the presence of God because of the great treachery of our sins. Because the more unclean we were, or the more unclean Israel was, or where their social standing was, or anything like that, the further they were from the presence of God. That's why only the priests could work in the room right outside the Holy of Holies. But once again, what does it show us? It shows us that a holy God cannot dwell with an unholy people. That's why we need priests, because they were continually to offer sacrifices that cleansed the people so that God's presence could live and dwell in their midst. But despite all the sacrifices day after day, all the work, the contamination of rebellion would still build up to such a degree that even the most holy place would need to be cleansed. And so God's solution to this, what he gave them in Leviticus 16, is called the Day of Atonement. It was the greatest day on the Jewish calendar, for on that day, the high priest, and the high priest alone, would offer a sacrifice for his own sins, and then do two things. The first thing he would do would be to take a goat, to sacrifice it, and then to do something that nobody was ever allowed to do. Enter past the veil, past the curtain, and into the Holy of Holies, where he would take the blood of the goat, he would sprinkle it on the mercy seat or onto the Ark of the Covenant, and there, as a substitutionary sacrifice, the sins of the people, all their contamination, all their rebellion, all their evil was forgiven. The second thing that the priest would do would be to take another goat, and he'd put his hands on it, and he'd confess over it the sins of all the people, and then he'd put it outside of the camp as a sign that Israel's sin had now been removed and now pushed away. But here's the problem. That day came every single year, because the sin never stopped. It continued to pile up as a stench. And so while it was glorious, while it offered this reprieve, it was momentary. Because again, the high priest could only enter after cleansing himself with a sacrifice. He had to leave because he was a sinner. And so the sin that was cast away, the sin that was covered up and cleansed, would continue again, and the guilt of the people would mount. So for example, just by way of illustration to that, and then again an explanation, I'm not very automotive friendly. And so I've had in the past either a leak in my tire or my radiator or other places. And my motto with vehicles is you just plug your ears and you say, if you can't hear it, there's no problem. But one time I had a hole in my radiator, and all I would do, because I didn't have the ability to fix it, was to top it up. And then I'd go drive. And unfortunately, I had to top it up more and more regularly, but it would get me from point A to point B. Yet the issue with that is that it cost a ridiculous amount of money in the long run, and it simply allowed the problem to persist until eventually it got worse. And that's the problem that was happening here, is that the Israelites, their problem was that their sin never went away. Their leak always continued. And so while the priest's duty would buy them time, it couldn't heal them. The priest couldn't purify the people and make them righteous before God. And there were two reasons for that. The first, of course, was that they couldn't offer something that paid the debt that we owed. Hebrews 10, chapter 1 says, "The law and the priesthood can never, by the same sacrifices that are continually offered every year, make perfect those who draw near." The idea, of course, being that a bull's blood is not equal to a human's soul. The second reason, then, is because the high priests themselves were guilty of the same sins. So just imagine that you've committed this crime and are assigned a lawyer, only to find out that the lawyer has committed and been convicted of the exact same crime that you have. It's why Calvin says one of the defects of the ancient priesthood, or the Levitical priesthood, was that the high priest offered sacrifices for his own sins. How then could he have pacified God for others who had God justly displeased with himself? You see, when we look at the entire priesthood and we look at the Day of Atonement and we look at its continual nature, what it screams to us year after year for well over 1,000 years is that there is no human mediator, there is no intercessor that can ever represent us as clean before God. We have all fallen. We have all sinned. And there is nothing in this world, no pastor, no priest, no lawyer, no law, no sacrifice, or anything else that can ever make you and I right with God. The Levitical priesthood was weak. It failed. It couldn't save. And that is why the Lord always planned for another, a different and perfect priesthood, one that could cleanse us from all unrighteousness. With that, if we go into our passage and we start at verse 26, it begins by telling us that it is thus fitting that we have another or a different high priest, one who is unstained, one who is holy, and one who is set apart. But before we look at that, we want to see how in the world is this possible? Because if you'll remember, to be a priest, one had to be descended from Levi. And of course, we're talking about Jesus here, but he was descended from Judah. That factors so heavily into him being a king. So how, if he's from Judah, could he be a priest if he's not from Levi? Well, the answer to that is unlocked in the book of Hebrews and in Hebrews chapter 7 especially. And it is that 500 years, give or take, before the priesthood existed, we see the word priest appear in Scripture for the first time. And it is referring to a man named Melchizedek. Well, Melchizedek, as mysterious as they come, he was the king of Jerusalem nearly 2,000 years before David captured the city, nearly 1,000 years before David captured the city and Solomon built the temple. His name translated means king of righteousness, and has he's the king of Salem before the Jeru was added, Salem being Shalom. He is also called the king of peace. the king of peace. Well, what we see in his story in Genesis 14 is that Abraham, who is the great man of faith, he comes and Abraham tithes to him. In other words, he's saying, you are greater, I give to you. And it also shows and it symbolizes, we're told at the beginning of Hebrews chapter 7, is that Abraham's great-grandchild and all the priests to come with him and all the believers to come with him are tithing to Melchizedek's priesthood as well. And then also on top of that, Melchizedek blesses Abraham, which is a privilege granted only to the priests. In other words, what we're shown there is that the job of the priest is executed by Melchizedek, a non-Israelite, to Abraham. And again, in Hebrews chapter 7, it tells us that this mysterious figure is thus greater than the man who is known as the father of all believers. Well, that happens in Genesis 14, and then Melchizedek disappears from history. That is, until right in the middle time between Melchizedek and Christ in Psalm 110, verse 4, where the Lord promises that the coming Messiah, the one who will be the king of righteousness, the one who will be the king of peace, he will also be a priest. But he will not be a priest in the failed order of Levi. That could make no changes. That could make nothing better. Rather, we are told the Lord has sworn and will not change his mind that this Messiah, this Jesus, will be a priest in the order of Melchizedek. A priesthood that existed for eternity. A priesthood built on an indestructible life. A priesthood that was established far before Israel was even a nation, even before the covenant with Abraham, even before the covenant of circumcision. And so what that means is that, again, Jesus is from a different priesthood. And thus he is not bound to minister under the same rules and regulations and covenant as the Levitical priests. Because where the Levitical priests were intercessors of the Mosaic covenant of the law, here Jesus is the high priest and the intercessor of the new covenant that promises a boundless grace and continually cleanses us and grants us eternal access to God. And so where the Levites constantly fail, we're told that Jesus can't. Again, notice his qualifications in verse 26 as laid out in our passage. We're told he is holy, he is innocent, he is unstained. Where the high priests of the day were sinners, we are told that Jesus is separated from sinners. Where the high priest ministered on earth and couldn't go into the presence of God, we are told that Jesus is exalted above the heavens. Again, Aaron and his fellow high priests that came after him, they could not enter the presence of God to represent and cleanse the people except for one moment, one time a year. But Jesus is able to stand in the presence of God forever. Not only that, but where the high priest would need to continually bring forth a sacrifice for his own sin and for the sins of the people to abate the wrath of God, Jesus offered himself as the final sacrifice. For where an animal could not pay the price of man's debts, the blood of the Son of God was more than enough to cancel the price that we owed. And so you see, by being in the order of Melchizedek, by not being in the long line of Levitical priests, the two failures of the Levites are rectified and fulfilled by Christ. And so what that means is that we don't have a day of atonement anymore, because the day of atonement was always pointing forward to the cross, when Jesus, in all of his perfection, would bring the final sacrifice to more than pay the debt that we owed, and wherein he would be raised to new life and finally ascended to the highest heaven before the throne of God, not simply as God himself, not simply as the conquering king, but as our high priest, our representative. You see, he finished what the Levites never could. He accomplished what they failed year after year to do. And so Paul sums it up by saying, "And you, who were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all of our trespasses by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing to the cross. He disarmed the rulers and the authorities, and he put them to open shame by triumphing over them in him." What we're told there is where the Levites failed year after year after year after year. Through his once-for-all sacrifice, Jesus paid the debt to God that we owed, and he entered into the Holy of Holies, where we're told in our passage he will continue as a high priest forever. Now, to take that, and to try to drive that home to us today, that key word at the end of our passage, forever, is one that should offer us great hope. Because it means that Jesus didn't simply free us and retire. Rather, he continued to battle with sin. Or rather, he continues to battle against our sin. Because as we are told we continue to battle against sin, Jesus continues forever to act as our representative before God until the day that we will see him face to face. You see, when the Bible talks about salvation, it talks about it progressively. Yes, it is true, we will not fail if we believe in Jesus to reach that finish line of those great pearly gates. But we are still now running the race. The world didn't end at the empty tomb. And so in that race, in your Christian life, you will have four enemies. The first one before you believe is God. Yet after we believe, after we have been reconciled through Jesus' priesthood to God, we will battle against the world and against the flesh and against the devil. And so while we have salvation, we need to continue being saved. And so because Jesus continues as our great high priest forever, it means that day by day he continues to save his people. So think about what that means for you, because you know what it's like to be overcome with the busyness of this life, and then to remember your Lord and to bow the knee and have nothing to say. Or you know what it's like to bow the knee and to have all your failures flood to mind. After all, we're told that yes, while the devil is a tempter, he is equally an accuser. Go back into the Old Testament, it's the definition of his name. But look at Job, or look at Joshua in Zechariah 3, or go into the New Testament in Revelation 12. Because there we're told that Satan always accuses the saints. He hopes to render our faith ineffective and thus rob us of our joy in Christ. He knows he can't steal us from heaven. He knows he can't pry us from God's hand, but he wants to make us miserable. And so he's always at war against us. He's always fighting against us. But because Jesus continues forever, day after day, moment by moment, to be our high priest, it means that in every battle, in every trial, you and I have a representative in heaven. We have one who cannot fail. One who fights for us. One who is perfect. One who stands apart from sin. One who is holy and has fully paid the debt. It's why, as we read, Hebrews 4 exclaims, "Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace." Remember, no one could do that under the Levitical priesthood. Now you and I are called to draw near the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. In other words, what that word forever means is that in all your wanderings, all your comings and your goings, all your highs and your lows, Jesus stands eternally in the Holy of Holies, in the highest heavens, and represents you as pure and righteous before your Father, so that no matter where life takes you, you will stand victorious at the end, because Christ never fails to save. Is why in John 6:39 he said, "And this is the will of him, the Father who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day." And then in 1 Peter 1:4-5, the apostle writes, "You have an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of salvation." Continually, Jesus is mediating for you. Continually, Jesus is fighting for you. Or look at Acts chapter 7, there with the martyr Stephen. He is being stoned to death for his faith in Christ. And he looks to the heaven, it opens, and what does he see? He sees the Son of God standing at the right hand of the Father. Notice that Jesus wasn't sitting, because he is still at work. He is still upholding Stephen. He is still interceding for him, ready to carry his soul past the finish line and welcome him into glory. That's why Hebrews 7:25 says he is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. That means that day and night, forever and ever, Jesus stands before the throne of God praying for you. And unlike the high priest of the Old Testament, again, who couldn't stand in the Holy of Holies, who needed prayers for themselves, the prayers of Christ Jesus are powerful and they are effective because they are perfect. For example, again, when Satan had asked to sift Peter like wheat, Jesus says, "Peter, I have prayed for you that your faith may not fail." And then he moves on to show how effectual his prayers are when he says, "And when you have turned again, strengthen your brothers." You see, as one pastor tells us, it is good news indeed that Christ prays for his people, because it means that he cannot fail to save his elect. Being the Son of God, he knows how to intercede for us before his Father perfectly, such that none of his own will ever be lost. As your great high priest, Jesus not only saves you once for all, but he walks every step of the journey with you, strengthening you and praying for you. He promises much in the Great Commission when he said, "Go, for I am with you always, even to the end of the age." And if we need proof, just look at the book of Revelation. There, John sees Jesus glorified in all of his splendor. And what is he wearing? A golden sash, which is a distinguishing mark of the priest. In other words, we are told that Jesus forever is your great high priest. He doesn't take a day off. He doesn't blink and miss anything. And so if you're ever scared, or when you feel weak, or when you lose hope, or when you feel unloved, or when the accuser whispers shame and guilt in your ear, never forget that you have a great high priest in heaven, and as your high priest, he is your representative before God, and he lives to make prayers for all those who believe in him. Before God, you have someone who is on your side, someone who is strengthening you, someone who is interceding for you. Even when you forget him, he is praying for you. It's why Paul says, "And you who were once alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death, in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him." Notice again what that means. It does not mean that Jesus is holding back the Father's unbreaking wrath. We're told in that passage, right? He has now reconciled us by his death. God's wrath was satisfied. In 2 Corinthians 5:18, the apostle tells us again, we have been reconciled to God through Christ Jesus. And so what that means is that his prayers for you are not constantly offering sacrifices to cleanse you like the Levites. Rather, they are prayers that strengthen. They are prayers that sustain. Because as we're told in Romans, by faith in Jesus, God is for us. And so what that means again is that you cannot be lost. He is continuing to battle your enemies of the flesh, the devil, and the world, so that you can grow in righteousness before him. It's why Peter tells us that as Christ is our high priest, you and I are now a priest to the believers, because he is our only mediator. He is our only intercessor. He, our Lord Jesus, is our greatest champion. And we are set apart from him, given access to the place where no one in the Old Testament could dwell, the throne of the highest heaven. Again, as your high priest, he is fighting for you. He is presenting you as blameless. So trust in him and his continuing work, for you are never forgotten before the throne of God. After all, and I'll close with this, in Leviticus 16, the high priest was to change into different clothes. And one of the distinctive things that he wore, one of the things he wore only when he stood before the presence of the Lord, was a breastplate on which were written the names of the 12 tribes of Israel. The Lord then gives the reason in Exodus 28. He says, "So Aaron shall bear the names of the sons of Israel in the breastplate of judgment on his heart when he goes into the holy place, to bring them to regular remembrance before the Lord." Because Jesus is your high priest, your name is emblazoned forever over his heart in the throne room of the highest heaven. So that second by second for all eternity, it can be brought to regular remembrance before the Lord. Because Jesus is your great high priest, you are never forgotten. You are never forsaken. You are never unloved. He has paid the debt in full, and he is upholding you by his mighty prayers. Call on him. He's not against you. He's fighting for you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you have sent your Son, not simply to be the prophet that speaks to us your will, but to be our priest, who has saved us and is continuing to fight for us, who is continually presenting us blameless, who has no need to offer another sacrifice, because he has redeemed us. Help us to trust in his work. Help us to call on him when we are lost. Help us to love him for what he has done. Because it's in his name that we can call you Father, and it's because of his name and his blood that we even stand here and say, Amen.
Priest.
again, have a wonderful Mother's Day and a wonderful time today if you are with your family. But now go into this week with the blessing of the Lord that was commanded by God of the high priest to give. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.